including many prophets of ancient and modern Hindus. You see, the Hindu religion is unique. It says you can, the God experience is not just confined to people who lived 5,000 years ago, 2,000. It should be possible for you to have God experience today in the 21st century. So it is open. It says a universal phenomena. If one human being experienced it about 5,000, you can still do it. Otherwise, it's gone wrong. Serious, that was wrong anywhere. So it must be continuous. It must be possible today. So this experiential side, we love, we thrive on it. We say, we told you so. This is where the real proof lies, in the eating. The proof of the pudding is in the eating. You need to experience this God for yourself. And with this part, we love. We really, if you like, absorb this idea, and it has become the central teaching of the Hindu religion. That's why it's a unique religion. It's an experiential religion, not a belief system. Experiential. You must be able to experience this thing called God for yourself. Otherwise, you can always question it. Otherwise, you can say, I'm an agnostic. I don't know if God is for real. I don't know. I haven't seen him. Nice to be humble like that, than to make bombastic claims. And this is what our religion, this religion makes you say, recognize, be humble. I heard about God, I read about him, and this prophet was excited by him, so that excites me. That's all. I need to do this work myself. And the aim of Hindu life is not to believe and then die. The aim of Hindu life is to start your journey with belief, and in this lifetime, turn it into experiential religion. Experience this thing for yourself. Powerful thoughts, wonderful thoughts. You see, there is one other thing I'm going to touch on today. This might rattle some of you, but I'm used to rattling people. And I like this to be going to the society and let rattle other people too. It's not because I'm just a troublemaker. It's because I want to stir you up, make you think about your religion for yourself. So what are the key features? What is another area where people say, oh, this is how we can be sure about God? What's another area? Another area people use to a given kind of explanation, that's a miracle. Miracle. See, now, let's examine this philosophically. So I'm going to rattle you. You'll go, Dilipai, don't do this to us. Surely, miracle is the best proof of God. Because if God has created the universe and the laws of nature, it is God who should have the power to bend the laws of nature, twist them, suspend them if necessary. This is how we define. This is why, good chap, this God. He created, why can't he disturb the laws of nature that he created? We can't do it, but he can do it, like Superman. This is why we like Superman, have you noticed? Superman is able to suspend the laws of nature. He can, he's got X-ray vision, he can see through. He can turn time backward. You know, he goes zoom, 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 goes back and the world goes backward and turns time backward. He says, wow, this chap, he flies. Gravity, what gravity? You see, he's suspending. So he says, this God must be like that, super. He must be able to bend the laws of nature at will. Now, this may sound fine, and some religions actually swear by miracles. If you don't have a miracle, the religion will collapse. Let me give an example. You'll be shudder, you'll be surprised. Whole of Christianity is based on this idea. What's the miracle? The whole of Christianity is based on the idea that when Christ died, then he rose from the dead. That person got up after he cheated death. That is the biggest miracle, resurrection. If you take away resurrection from Christianity, whole of Christianity crumbles. This is the cornerstone of the theology, the doctrine. If you take away resurrection, boom, whole religion collapses. So this idea is not just only to say, oh, God must bend the rules of nature. One religion is just based on the whole idea of miracle. Foundation is miracle. There are other reasons why miracles are crucial or perhaps useful. One of the reasons is, well, you see, this might help convert other people. If I can show that I can do some weird things here, people say, wow, they'll sit at my feet. I can convert them, make them sit at my feet. You see? It might convince people there is God because I can do these powerful things. These are the different reasons why miracles are crucial, important to examine. Now, I'm going to do a philosophic prying, very sharp. You may shudder, but shudder, so be it. You see, this so far sounds okay, but then you see, first thing that we have to ask ourselves is, people who talk about miracles, normally, test them out. And normally, this is, who does this? By the way, it's not me, eh? I'm talking, using somebody very powerful. A very famous Scottish philosopher called David Hume. He makes people of religion shudder and even pee in their pants. He's very rough. He's a marvelous philosopher. If you go in your library, pick up anything on David Hume, some of his lovely material, it will make you shudder. You can see the man is very stable. He's not a wacko. He's not outgunning for religions. He's a pure and pure rationalist. He just thinks for himself, using his common sense, tries to work things out. So David Hume said, look, my first problem is this, you chaps. You see, the people who talk of miracles, oh, this happened, very likely this would have happened in any case. There's always a chance that things sometimes combine together in a unique manner and produce something. You say, oh, miracle. It was bound to happen sooner or later. Sometimes things can gang up like that. Haven't you noticed? Just fortunate circumstances coming together and producing results. Say, oh, this is a miracle. So maybe just a lot of fortunate circumstances combining together and producing a result which we are defining as miracle. That's one criticism. The second criticism from David Hume is very severe. He's very rude. He says people who normally talk about miracles are already people who are converted. They want to see a miracle, so they see a miracle. If there are people like that. I want to believe in a miracle. Suppose I believe in some. I want to believe in it. Then it will happen in front of me because I'll start seeing things which are not there even. I conjure it up to convince myself. And he uses very rude words. I'm not using them. I'm using his own language, smiling away. I'm just plugging them away. He said, normally miracles attract the uneducated and excitable. Not the sober, sane thinkers, but those, oh yeah, uneducated, excitable people. It's a very rude thing to say. So he's telling, don't rely on miracles. Now let us explore the whole phenomena of miracles. You'll see how interesting it is. Let me give you some weird examples. You'll see why it is an interesting thing to examine and explore. Let me give you an example. Suppose you say, you know, somebody was ill in the family and you prayed to God, oh God, please, 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 God, say, oh, this is my near and dear one, please save his life. And you pray day and night and that person recovers. See, that's a miracle. You prayed and God listened to you and made that person better. What a lovely God. Lovely way of proving this God. My question would be this. Why did God only listen to your prayer? Because you believe in God and you prayed. God should be so merciful, so loving and so compassionate. He should help those people who don't know even there is a God. So those guys who don't know there is even a God, they don't know how to pray even. God should say, poor chaps, they don't know I exist even. They don't know how to pray to me. They need more help. They should make them recover better, faster. Surely this is what God should do. He's partial. Only if you pray to him, then he does. Suppose I'm such a silly man, I don't even know about God. He should say, oh, poor chap, I must help him even more and make the person get better. So why does he only help be partial? Why is he partial?